So my new ESP32-TV boards have arrived from PCBWay. As you can see, they're all working. So the speaker's working, the infrared control's working, and the SD card is being read by the ESP32 to play the video. So this board fixes a few of the issues we had in the previous board. So one of the problems we had previously is the USB 2244 was conflicting with the ESP32. So what was happening is there was a hidden pull-up resistor on the reset line, which was causing the USB 2244 to be active at the same time as the ESP32, and then the USB wasn't connecting. So we fixed that with this this little bodge resistor that basically made my pull-down resistor on the reset line a lot stronger, and that fixed that problem. So if we look on the new board, what we have now is we have this little MOSFET which is holding the reset line low so we don't conflict with the ESP32. So that solves the problem of these two ICs conflicting. Now the other issue we had, which I can show if I bring in my multimeter, is the battery charger on the old board. We slightly messed up the connections on that. And if I show you the voltage on the battery pins, you'll see the problem there. So let's try and probe that. So if we probe the two pins here, then what you can see is we're trying to put 4.8 volts straight into the battery. So what I'd done is I'd messed up the power control circuit and I basically connected the USB straight through to the battery. So not what you want to be doing. So if we look on the new board, and I've got a battery connected to this, so we should see some sensible voltages. So let's just plug this in. And then we'll measure the voltage at the battery. So let's just probe that. So there you can see a much more sensible charging voltage. So we're getting around 4.2 volts coming into the battery, which is what we should be getting. So that's those two fixes put in place on this new board, and it seems to be working pretty well. So that's good. There are some more notable additions. So what we now have, I realized I had some spare pins, so I've removed one of the quick connections. So on the previous board, which is over here, we had these two quick connectors. I decided to actually only need one quick connector, so we just have one quick connector. I have now used the correct logo for that as well, and that meant I freed up some pins, so I thought, why not add a microphone? I thought that might be a useful addition to our board. So let's flash a little sketch onto the system and try out the microphone. So I've flashed my TFT audio monitor onto the board. Let's play a bit of music and we can see that working. So that also works pretty well. Interestingly, this is a PDM microphone. Now it's actually getting surprisingly hard to get PCM microphones, and PDM microphones are remarkably cheap compared to the old PCM microphones that I used to use. So I used to use the ICS43434, which was a PCM microphone, but this is just a PCM microphone, and it's about a third the price of the ICS43434. It's pretty good, seems to work well, so that's quite a nice addition. I think we can revisit some of the previous audio projects that we've done and use this board to try them out. So everything on the board is working nicely, so our USB 2244 is not conflicting with the ESP32, the infrared receiver is working, the screen's working, and the microphone's working. So the whole point of doing this in the first place was to make the access to the SD card much faster. So we can use the ESP32 in a mass storage class mode, and that will let us talk via the USB to the ESP32 to the SD card. So I've downloaded this sketch to the ESP32 to switch it into mass storage mode. So let's see what the speed is when we're just using the ESP32. So I've got a little command here that will write a file. So this will write around 10 megabytes to the ESP32 and SD card. And you can see our little LED is flashing, showing that we're writing some data. So that took about 10 or 11 seconds to write 10 megabytes. Let's test the read speed. So we'll clear all the caches. And now let's try reading the file. So again, that gets us a similar result, so around 10 seconds. And we can repeat this process and we get pretty consistent results. We sort of top out at around 1 megabyte per second writing and 1 megabyte per second reading. Now the limitation here is just the USB implementation on the ESP32. That's all it can actually do. So we can't really get much faster than this. And I've done a lot of hacking around to try and make it faster. So what I did was I added the USB 2244 chip. So what that allows us to do is we can hand off the SD card to the USB 2244 and then have that talk over USB, which should be much faster. So let's give that a go. So I've flashed a sketch onto the ESP32, and the ESP32 is just playing this animated GIF of David Bowie playing with his balls. Now what I've done is I've wired up the boot button, so when we hit boot, we should switch over to the USB 2244 and hand the USB over to it. So let's try hitting the boot button. So there we go, we've got USB 2244 on, and we can see the activity LED for the USB 2244. So let's try the speed test again and see how well that works. So we'll write a file. We need to come back into the SD card and let's try writing our file. So there we go, we now write 10 megabytes in just over 1 second, and I can repeat that, and we get even faster depending on sort of how things are working. So let's clear all the caches again and we'll try reading this file. So again, doing about half a second. So we're writing in around 10 megabytes per second or maybe 17 megabytes per second. And we're reading in about 20 megabytes per second. So that's a massive speed up in terms of SD card performance. This is particularly useful if we're writing video files to the SD card. Now, of course, we can just unplug the SD card and plug it into our computer, but that's not very convenient. Now, the only slight annoying thing with this is to get out of the mass storage mode, we have to hit the reset button and reboot everything. And now we're back to David Bowie playing with his balls again. So there we go, nice little animated GIF. And then we can just do USB 2244 activated, our little flashing light turns on, and we're connected to the computer via the USB 2244, and to the SD card. So that's a really nice fast connection. So that's working really well. So we've achieved our goal of this entire project. So we now have a tiny TV working. We have a super fast access to our SD card. I mean, I say super fast, it's still USB 2. Maybe at some point we'll look at USB 3. That could be an interesting project. So we can copy video files onto the SD card and then we can play them on the tiny TV. So that's a pretty good result. Now, there's one thing I'm not too happy about, and that's the display. Now, as you can see, I've had to solder the ribbon cable on directly to the PCB. Now, the problem is the standard pitch that is used for this display, or this particular display, is 0.7 millimeters. Now, that does not match any known connector standard known to man. So it's been impossible to find a socket that I can plug this directly into. And that's okay for me, I can solder this on. I did have a few issues when I was soldering. The first few tries didn't really work very well. I didn't make good connections in all the pins, but it's not ideal. So what I really want to do is get a socket for this. So I was recently looking at the Unexpected Maker Tiny Watch. Now if we crack this open, the display is actually the same size as my display, and he's managed to find a nice one with a connector. So I'm kind of tempted to switch over to using the same display as he's using and get rid of my display, which has the funny non-standard connector. It's actually the Tiny Watch that inspired me to put a microphone on my board, because I thought that actually looks quite nice. Now, the only issue is, if we look at the schematic for the Tiny Watch, we can see that we need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 pins to control the screen. Now, if we look at my screen, we only need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, plus maybe one for turning the screen on and off. So we have 6 pins and we need 9 pins. So that's a bit tricky. And we still probably need our control for the power for the thing. So we actually need 10 pins. So I need to find another 4 pins to actually drive the touch version of the display and have a nice connector. Now, there are a couple of options that I could do. So one of the things I have at the moment is I have several different controls for powering things. So I have a control for the TFT, I have one for the IR power, I have one for the SD card. So that's 3 controls that could probably be put all onto one control. So I would get 2 pins from that. So that's 2 pins I can find. The other thing I have is I do have these 2 battery monitors and power monitor for the USB. So I can detect when the USB is connected and I can detect when the battery is connected. So potentially that's 2 pins that I could free up if I get rid of the battery monitor and the USB power detect. So that would give me 4 pins, which would give us what we need. The other options I have is there is the built-in LED pin, so I could lose the LED. Or what I could do is get rid of having 4 power low lines for the SD card. So that would free up 2 pins, so maybe that would be an option as well. So not entirely sure what to do in this situation. I do quite fancy having a nice socket for the display. It just makes life much easier, and this sort of soldering, it's just not ideal. It's very fragile. The display moves around quite a bit, and it's very easy for the ribbon to be damaged or the soldering to be damaged. It's not particularly robust. So let me know what you think in the comments. Shall we try and put a nice touchscreen onto our tiny TV project?